A specific class of random matrices called pattern matrices, and I'll show you some examples first, and then I'll discuss moment method. That moment method can be used to capture the behavior of the bulk of the eigenvalues that I'll discuss, and then I'll come to joint convergence of class of matrices. This is a plan of my talk. First, as I said, first, I'll discuss what random matrix is and what pattern random matrix is. I'll show you some examples, and then that ESD and LSD is the behavior of the bulk of the eigenvalues. And using moment method, we can study this ESD and LSD. And then I'll come to the joint convergence of a class of matrices. So first, I'll show you some example of joint convergence of matrices. And this defined type of matrix, so defined type of limiting behavior in joint convergence. And finally, if I get time, I'll come to a general theorem on pattern matrices of joint convergence. So random matrix is a matrix with random inputs. For example, you can think is a n by n matrix with IID Gaussian entry, for example. So the well-known example in this field is a Wigner matrix. It appeared during around 1958 in nuclear physics due to Wigner. So this is a symmetric matrix. So Xij equals Xji. And here Xij's are IID basically means 0, and you can take variance 1 also. And the other example, well-known example, is the IID matrix. Here the symmetry is not there, so entries are Xij. And this is a well-known matrix because is related to well-known circular law in this area. And it's probabilistically looks simpler because more independence is there, but it is very hard to tackle this matrix. Now it's a big class of matrix with a pattern random matrix. Pattern random matrix mean basically the entries follow the pattern. So before the formal definition, first we define input sequence. Input sequence is the sequence of variables that used to construct a matrix. So it may be a single sequence Xi, or it may be a double sequence Xij. And we'll assume this Xi or Xij's are IID. So the pattern random matrix is the ijth entry is given by this formula, by this function, x suffix ln of ij, where ln is a function which captures the pattern, and we call this ln as a link function which defined on 1 to n squared to z or z2. So we'll see some example first. So sometimes pattern, basically this link function depend on n, but sometimes it may not depend on n, and in that case we'll drop the n and we'll denote it by l. The link function is a map from 1 to n. Ln is a map from 1 to n squared to z or z2.
And it represents?
It represents the pattern of the matrix in this function. I'll show you some examples. It will be clear.
Okay.
So for example, you consider the symmetric Toeplitz matrix. So you can, here link function is Lij is, so that Lij is a mod of I minus j. Here the link doesn't depend on n. So if you follow this, so the entries are x of, as I showed you, so entries are the x of ln of ij. So if you follow this formula, and you'll get that all the diagonal entries are x0, x sub is mod of I minus j. So that will be x0 and the diagonal, upper and below diagonal will be x1 and so on. Similarly, another well-known example is the Hankel matrix. So this is a link function in L of ij is I plus j. And in that case also, it doesn't depend on the n. So we denote it by only, we denote only by L. And this kind of the opposite of Toeplitz matrix. In Toeplitz matrix, all the diagonals are same, and the above and below diagonals also same. But in the Hankel case, the opposite direction, these are same. Means the first anti-diagonal is x2, then x3, all anti-diagonals, then x4, and so on. So similarly, on two more examples. So this is called reverse circulant matrix, first one. Here, link is depend on n, that is I plus j minus 2 mod n. So the first will come is x0, x2, x1, 2 dot dot, x of n minus 1, and so on. And this is called hypercirculant because if you take a look, so second row is just first row shifting by one position in the left side. So the x1 has come here, x2 is there, and there was x3, so x3 is now there, and x0 is moved to the last spot. Yeah, the difference is that, just go to the ankle. So here all things are different, right? So here is x2, then x3, x4, and below that angle x of n plus 2. So here the number of independent entries is 2n, and there the reverse circulant case, the number of independent entries is n, because so below the diagonal, this is x0 is there, and top also x0. That is the difference. And for the symmetric circulant, this is a symmetric matrix, and it looks little complicated. Link function. So here Lij is n by 2 minus mod n by 2 mod of I minus j, and it also depends on n. So it is basically symmetric matrix, and but its structure is very simple. If you observe that the first row is a palindrome. So you go x0, x1, x2, dot, 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 x of n by 2, then x of n by 2 minus 1, again x2, x1. Now you shift the whole thing by one position in the right side. You'll get this matrix, whose link function is this. Similarly, we can write Wigner matrix as also a link. Also, we can think Wigner matrix also as a pattern matrix, because you can write Lij as a minimum of ij, maximum of ij. And in that case, it is also a class of example of a pattern matrix. So today we will mainly concentrate on the symmetric pattern matrices. So now, so there are different type of problems in random matrix theory. One problem is the study the behavior of the bulk of the eigenvalues. So you have n eigenvalues. So question how that these n eigenvalues behave. So one is that you take a n by n matrix, you have n eigenvalues, put 1 by n mass to each eigenvalue, and you will get a distribution function, that is f and x. That is called empirical spectral distribution, that is summation 1 by n, summation I 1 to n, indicator lambda I, this indicator lambda I less equals to x. So you are putting 1 by n mass to each of the eigenvalues. And this is called the empirical spectral distribution function. And suppose you have now sequence of matrices. N is a sequence of n matrices of dimension n. So in each case, we have a distribution function, that fn. If this fn converges weakly to some distribution function, we say that f is the limiting spectral distribution of the sequence of matrices. So that the notation is fn converges to f weakly, and the weak limit of f of ESD is called the limiting spectral distribution, as I've said. So now thing is that in random matrix, so for each realization, means the since the entries are random, for each omega, suppose, so you have probability space omega script f p, and suppose entries are defined on this space. Suppose xij's are the entries defined on this space. So for each omega, fixed omega, you have a n by n matrix, and you have a sequence, you have n eigenvalues. You are taking its empirical spectral distribution. So here fn is random. So in this situation, that for each in this situation, the limiting spectral distribution may be random, may not be random. So most of the cases, what happens is that the f is non-random. So so it f may be random, may not be random. So in most of the cases, f is non-random. So suppose in that case, the fn converges to f weakly in some probabilistic notion, right? So it may be in almost sure sense or in probabilistic sense. So for example, we say that fn converges to f almost surely weakly means almost every omega belongs to big omega, that fn omega dot converges to f. So for each omega, you have a distribution function, but the for almost all omega, that fn omega converges to f. Here f is non-random. So basically, if we consider the entries are ID, mean 0, variance 1, and in most of the cases, the f will be non-random. So now there are several methods of showing this convergence of ESD to LSD. Two interesting methods is a moment method and Stiles-Johnson method. Today, we'll mainly discuss the moment method. So suppose the moment method is like this. Suppose you have xn, the sequence of random variable with distribution function fn. And suppose there is a sequence beta h such that nth, hth moment of xn converges to beta h for all h greater equals 1. And beta h satisfies some condition like this. Means beta 2h minus 1 by 2 is finite, is infinity. The sum is infinity. This is known as Carlyman condition. And if such condition holds, then it is well known that hth moment of, so there is a distribution function f such that whose hth moment of beta h and xn converges to, xn converges to f weakly when fn, the distribution function fn converges to f weakly. So this is the moment method. So we can apply this method to our setup also. So you have a n sequence of random matrices, and beta hn is hth moment of n, which is divided by beta h fn also. And suppose this beta h fn, which is a random quantity, and suppose it converges to beta h, and where beta h is at the non-random, and beta h satisfies the Carlyman condition, this condition, then the LSD of n exists and is identified by beta h. But the problem is that this beta h n is random and this non-random. So here the beta h n converges to beta h in some probabilistic sense. For example, if you show this condition, expectation of beta h n converges to beta h, which is expected hth moment of the empirical spectral distribution, which converges to beta h, and you show that variance of beta h n also goes to 0, both will imply that beta h n converges to beta h in probability, and from there you can conclude that fn converges to f in probability. And to get the almost sure convergence of the fn to f, you have to do something more. So if you can show this condition, fourth moment condition, you call it M4 condition. So expectation of beta h n minus expectation of beta h n to the 4 is, if this is finite, then you can show that from this condition, you can show that this beta h n converges to beta h almost surely, and from there, fn converges to f almost surely. So we'll mainly focus on M1 condition, which is the most difficult part to show, that expectation of beta h n converges to beta h. The idea is very simple. Means you have a matrix, you calculate you have ESD, empirical spectral distribution, you calculate its hth moment of that, take expectation, show that that converge. But thing is that the two showing that expectation of this thing converges to beta h, so lots of combinatorics involved in each case. So, and this differs with model to model. And some of the cases, it's very difficult to calculate the explicit expression of beta h. Only very few cases we have the explicit expression of beta h. So first take the first example. So consider the Wigner matrix. Suppose the entries are xij's are id, mean 0, variance 1, and suppose all the moments are finite. Basically, this condition is not needed. For simplicity, keep this. You can do only with the id and mean 0 and variance 1. And suppose, then you can show that using moment method, this converges weakly, almost surely, to the semicircular distribution S, which has the following density. 1 by 2 pi root of 4 minus x squared is supported around minus root 2 to plus root 2. And which has the 2kth moment is given by this formula. So main step in showing this that, as I've said, that expected kth moment converges to this quantity. So this takes, it's the main technical steps for showing this. Similarly, there is a list of, results for other pattern matrices. So you can take the entries are id, mean 0, variance 1. Then for the symmetric circulant, you can show that 2kth moment converges to this quantity, which is the 2kth moment of normal distribution. And from there, you can conclude that the LS is the standard normal distribution. For reverse circulant, it is k factorial. 2kth moment is k factorial, which is the standard Rayleigh distribution. And for the Toeplitz-Hankel, you can show that the 2kth moment converge, and it satisfies Carlyman condition also. So from that, you can conclude LSD exists, but explicit expression is not known. Similarly, for the Hankel matrix. In these two matrix, so lots of things are still unsolved. So till now you are working with on single matrix, and using that moment method, we have seen that one can show the ESGs converges to some distribution, which we call limiting spectral distribution. And limiting spectral distribution, and in few cases we have the explicit expression of the LSG, and in some cases we don't have. So now we can make our life a little more complicated. So suppose you have two Wigner matrix, WN1 and WN2, and with entries XIJ, YIJ, where XIJ and YIJ are ID with mean 0, variance 1, and all moments finite. Now you take any monomial in these two matrices. So Q is the monomial of WN1 and WN2, which is of the following form, WNI1, WNI2, and WNIP. Now question is that, does this limit converge? And if yes, does the limit show any kind of description? Point is that if you drop this 1 and 2 from this, means if you consider only one matrix, this is basically the some kth moment of Wigner matrix. So here we are considering some kind of mixed moment of two Wigner matrix. So answer is known. It is due to Wykulski in 1991. So he showed that this type of things converge, and it converges to some this kind of quantity, phi of Q, S1, S2. Q is the monomial, and S1 is to belong to some algebra FE, script FE, and marginals of S1, S2 are semicircular. So this is some kind of, these are the moments, we are calculating the moments, and we are getting some things here. So I'll make precise what I mean this. So now we can ask one question. So we have a joint convergence of two Wigner matrix. Now we can ask if we consider some other pattern matrix, for example, Toeplitz, Henkel, or symmetric circular, reverse circular, in place of WN, does this converge, that expression we have shown? So, and we have shown, and in the next few slides we show that in most of the cases this if we consider other matrices in replace of Wigner matrix, that will also converge, and the limit will show different kind of independence. So before going to state the main results, well, show you the results, I'll define some basic definition. So as I've said, so first is the non-commutative probability space. Non-commutative probability space is a pair, script and phi, where script is a unital complex algebra with unity 1, and phi is a linear functional satisfying this relation. Phi of 1 is 1. So the one of the simplest examples, here non-commutative means, and here the elements of this algebra called the non-commutative variable, and in general they are non-commutative. You can take this as an example. So suppose X, B, and mu is the probability space, and LP, X, script B, mu, D is the set of all random variables whose pth moment is finite. Now take intersection of over all P. So LP contains all the random variables which have all moments finite. So then L mu, script A is the L mu, and phi is the expectation, is a non-commutative probability space.
I guess you mean the star algebra and also quadratic function.
No. NCB, yeah.
Not NCB,
yeah. And these are moments are finite, means and the script, now second example is script N, which is a set of all N by N matrices whose elements are coming from this L mu, and phi is a 1 by N expectation trace or 1 by N trace. So these obviously elements here are is commutative, but the script N, the set of all N by N matrices, these are non-commutative. Now, so before going to the joint convergence of class of matrices, just define what I mean by joint laws and joint convergence. So suppose script F is a non-commutative probability space. And suppose you only to n are the elements of script A, then Then the joint distribution is a notation mu of suffix a1 a2n is a defined canonically by all mixed moments of the following form. So these are called the mixed moments, phi of ai1, ai2, im, where ai1, ai2, im belongs to 1 to n. And the joint distribution is the collection of all mixed moments, phi of ai1, ai2, im, where 1 less equals to ion, less equals to ai2, less equals to im, and belongs less equals to n. And here m is all greater equals to 1. So you are considering the all mixed moments, and this collection of mixed moments, we call it the joint distribution of mu. And joint convergence, suppose you have a n phi n is a sequence of non-commutative probability space, and AIN, I belongs, J is some index set, AIN belongs to n script n phi n. We say that jointly converges to that collection of AI, I belongs to J, which is a element of another non-commutative probability, say a phi, if this converges. This convergence means you take any polynomial of this element and consider is a phi of n of that, and as n tends to infinity, if this converges to phi of pai, then we call that n phi n, that a of ai n, I belongs to j, converges weakly to ai. And it has to happen for all p, all polynomials p. So before going to polynomial, we can check for monomials, and if we can check for monomials, then it is good enough. See, the phi's are linear. So we have a notion of joint convergence. So here is the notion of joint convergence in common setup. So if we consider the second example, so script n, where script n is a collection of all n by n matrices, and our entries are coming from that L mu, and here phi n is the 1 by n expectation trace, 1 by n expectation trace. In that case, suppose you have a collection of now matrices, x, I, n, I is running from 1 to p, and n denotes is the dimension, then we say that a xin jointly converges to ai, 1, that should be p, 1 less equals to a less equals to p belongs to script f v, if this happens. So here phi n is the 1 by n expectation trace. You take any polynomial p, apply on these random variables, apply on the matrices, you calculate this 1 by n expectation trace. If this converges as n tends to infinity to something, which is phi of pai, and it has to happen for all p, then we say that these matrices converges jointly to some random variables. And it has to happen for all p. And we'll show that in most of the pattern matrices, this convergence holds, and different matrix shows different type of limits in this case. Now first take the example one, so Wigner matrix. So Wigner matrix. So suppose FE, and before going to the results, I just give a definition of free, what I mean by free independence there. So suppose FE is a non-commutative probability space. Suppose script A is the subalgebra of script A. And we say that subalgebras are freely independent or simply free if this happens. So phi of A1, A2, AK is 0. Whenever phi of AJ is 0 for all J, and AJ belongs to script A I of J for J1 to K, and I1 not equals to I2, that is, and I2 not equals to I3, IK minus 1 not equals to IK. That is, consecutive elements are belongs to the different algebra. And each phi I has to be 0. And then if this quantity is 0, then we say that A1, A2, AN are free. That script AIs are free subalgebras. And similarly, suppose elements A and two elements A and B in the A and B in script are said to be free if subalgebra generated by them are free. Means just to have a two variable A and B, you just generate a subalgebra from them, and if these two subalgebras are free, we call A and B are free. And so which satisfies the following relation, phi of P1A, Q1B, and so on is will be 0. Similarly, other, whenever PJ and QJ are the polynomials, and phi of PIA is 0, and phi of QJ be also 0 for all IJ. So now come back to the Wigner matrix. So Wigner matrix case, this quantity, which is a mixed moment, which is a Q is a monomial, and you have considered the monomial of these two independent matrices. You have taken the 1 by n expectation trace, and this converges. And this converges to phi of q, s1 and s2. Where q is any monomial, s1, s2 at the law semicircular, and the jointly they are free. And they belong to some algebra. So that means this jointly converges to S1, S2, where S1, S2 are free and have marginal distribution as semicircular law. So the next easy example is a symmetric circular matrix. If you consider symmetric, so before going to the result of symmetric circular, is a, I have to define a notion which is independently known. So suppose A is an algebra, script A is at the subalgebras. Suppose the elements are elements commute, and we say that script A is a free, script A is a independent if phi of A1, A2n is product of phi of AI, where each AI belongs to some script AKI, and KI not equal to KJ for whenever I not equal to J. So that each A1, A2n belongs to some distinct algebras, and they commute, and when you take the trace, it will split. When you take that phi, and it will split. Just usual independence in classical probability theory. So here is just an example to show you the difference between free and independence. Suppose xy belongs to script A phi, and suppose phi x phi y is 0, and phi of x square phi of y square not equal to 0. And if xy commute and independent, then you can easily one can see that phi of xy x will be phi of x square y square, and since they are free, they are independent, they'll split, and that will be not equal to 0. Suppose xy doesn't commute, and they are free, in that case, phi of xy will be product phi x phi y and phi x phi y, and since all are 0, these are 0, that will be 0. So these are symmetric circular matrix, and have shown you that if Fn is the empirical spectral distribution, we have seen that empirical spectral distribution converges almost surely to standard normal distribution N. So using moment method, we have to show that this quantity converges to the 2kth moment of the normal distribution. And one can easily check that symmetric circular matrix commute. And if you take the P independent copies of symmetric circular matrix, where entries are in a specific matrix is independent and have mean 0, variance 1. And these SIs are, the symmetric circular matrices are independent across I. And suppose all moments finite, then you can show that SCI jointly converges to some NI, where these elements are independent, have same distribution, have marginals at the standard Gaussian law. So for Wigner case, the joint limit shows freeness, and for symmetric circular matrices, it shows independence. And third example, which I have shown that reverse circular matrix is shows different type of independence there. So before going to that, I need to define some notion first. So suppose A is an algebra, and A is an element of that algebra. We say that these elements are half commuting if following holds. Means Aij, Ai, Aj, Ak is Ak, Aj, I. Just middle one is fixed, and you can flip the sides one. Means Ai can take the place of Ak, and Ak take the place Aj, Ai. And this has to be true for all Ij, K. Then we say that this collection is half commuting. And one can easily see that if Ai is a half commute, then Ai square will commute with Aj and Aj square and for all Ij. For example, so that is A1, A1, A2. And if they are half commute AIs, that will be A1, A1, and that is A2, A1 square. And similarly, you can show that A1 square, A2 square will be A2 square, A1 square. So if AI is half commute, then square will commute. That commutative relationship. Okay. I have not checked.
And for if it is the same index, then it vanishes. AI square is simple. That family will also satisfy this.
Okay. So now, this A is a word, we call it word. So suppose you have collection AI1, AI2, AIK. Where AI1, I2, IK belongs to this index set J. And EIA denotes the number of AI which occurs in even position in A. And YA is the number of AI which occurs in odd position of A. For example, so if you take A is this, then U1A is 1, 1A is also 1. So if EIA, so you have a, here A is the, so here we have taken the A is A1, A1 into A2, A2, and here E1A is 1 and 1A is 1, E2A is 1 and 1A is 1. So if such happens for a word, we call it a symmetric word. Otherwise, we call it a non-symmetric word. And it has to happen for each I. I belongs to J. So for example, if we take this example, A1, A2, in this case, EIA, U1A is 0. So this, if you consider A equals A1, A2, A1, A2, this is not a symmetric word. And now comes the definition of half independence. Suppose A is a collection, I belongs to J, collection of variables in a non-commutative probability space, and they are said to be half commute, and suppose they are half commuting, and they are said to be half independent if AI square are independent, and phi of AI1, AI2, IK 0, whenever this word AI1, AI2, IK is non-symmetric. So again, so AI has to be half-commuting first, and AI square has to be independent, and if phi of this is 0, phi of this word will be 0, whenever AI1, AI2, AIK are the non-symmetric. And this is an example of that. Suppose eta is our IID complex Gaussian entry. You consider AI is as follows, 0, 0, eta, eta, e bar. Then one can easily check that these AIs are half commuting and they satisfy all these conditions. And with respect to 1 by A, that should be half expectation trace. So here if phi is this expectation trace and this belongs to this, AIs are element of M2 L mu at the set of all 2 by 2 matrices. And in this case, this collection of AI will be half independent. So now come to the reverse circulant matrix. So one can check that reverse circulant matrix half commute, first of all. And if you take collection of P copies of independent reverse circulant matrix, and suppose entries in a particular matrix are independent, have mean zero variance 1, and all moments finite, then this collection jointly converges to half independent element of these elements, which are, last example I have shown you, these are the half independent, and where A is this and eta is at the standard complex Gaussian. And in this case, marginal will be distributed like Rayleigh with 2kth moment is k factorial. So, still now, so for the symmetric circulant, we had independence, only independence. For Wigner, we had freeness, and for the reverse circulant, we have another kind of independence, which is half independence. So, how much time do I have?
How much time do you need?
Okay, I'll finish it in 2-3 minutes. Okay, then I'll skip this thing. So, just have.
Okay.
I think I have started late, 5 minutes late. It's okay. So, thing is that still now we have seen 3 examples of pattern matrices where we have joint convergence and we have defined type of limiting behavior, and there are some. I'll first show them one more example. So now you consider the other 2 examples, Toeplitz and Hankel matrix. In that case also you can show that that if you take p independent copies of Toeplitz or Henkel, that will also converge. And you can also show that Toeplitz limit, the limit will not be free or half independent or independent. But still the limiting behavior is not known yet, and that should be something new. Basically, for Toeplitz, the marginal case also, it is not so known yet because only known is that Toeplitz case, the limiting spectral distribution of Toeplitz case, it has unbounded support. And recently, Shen and Virag has shown that this has a bounded density. Nothing more is known. So to know the limiting behavior of joint convergence, first one has to get the proper idea, proper explicit expression of the limiting spectral distribution of Toeplitz, and this is an open and hard problem. And similarly for the Henkel matrix, it has only known is unbounded support, and the nothing is known. So in that case also the joint limiting behavior is not known. So similarly there are a few other modes, pattern matrices also. In that case only the joint convergence is known, but the limiting description is not known. So here's a summary what I've said so far. So using movement method, you have a notion of joint convergence and have not described the main result, which means roughly says that if marginal converge, then the jointly converge. And from that marginal limit, you can have an explicit expression of the joint limit also. And for Wigner case, this is the marginal limit semicircular. It shows freeness. For symmetric circulant, it shows the marginal limit is Gaussian. It shows independence. And reverse circulant, it is Rayleigh, and it limits shows half independence. And for the Toeplitz case, known fact is the bounded density. In this case, the unbounded support, but these two places are empty, so it's still open. So thank you.